So welcome to the second webinar of the Nectar Online Training of Trainers. This webinar is the one supposed to launch the second unit of our course that is about the main tools, the main characteristics of Nectar project. So we will provide an introduction to Nectar project and we will focus on the main tools that pilot teachers will have to take into account when involved in pilots. So as you can see from the table, the picture that provided is in this slide, the first part of unit one, the one devoted to introduce the iMOOCs platform, ends today, and the second part will be carried out at the end of the course. So we are now passing directly to unit two that will last more or less 3 weeks, and we will have two webinars in this unit. This one and the second one would be in 10 days, so in Friday the 7th, if I remember well. Anyway, you will find the link to every planned webinar inside the specific unit in the platform. So we won't send links anymore in the next, not to overcharge your mailbox, okay? The links are already defined and provided inside the platform. This unit envisages two main activities to be performed in two different forums, form activity 3 and for activity 4. Why 3 and 4? Because the activity 2 is inside unit 1, although it will be carried out at the end of October, okay? Activity 3 will be launched today and is preparatory to the 4th, and then the 4th will be launched after webinar 3. The contents of this webinar are included in a document we provided whose name is Nectar Results and Tools. You will find it in the platform available for download. So please try to understand what I'm saying in order to be able to ask if something is not clear, but you don't need to take notes because everything is written there. Okay? So what's the agenda for today? We will introduce the main aims and results of the Nectar project, so the curriculum for Chef Gastro Engineer, and we will deal with the compliance of the main vocational education and training standards at European level that are mandatory for our project. We will introduce the designer's kit that is a pool of tools delivered by the project supporting the design pilots. And then we will introduce our process for the design of pilots and the main tools that you have to deal with in the next weeks in order to contribute to the specific design of the pilots in your country. And then we will finally introduce the activity 3. So some of you already knows this, the main elements of this introduction. Anyway, we need this recap in order to contextualize the main results and tools of Nectar. So the main aim of Nectar project, here you have the link to the website in the event that you would like to take a look at it, is to overcome a mismatch that we have identified in the labor market between the skills that are currently offered by cooks and chefs working in hospitals, residential care and home care, with the skills that are actually demanded by healthcare institutions, private service providers, and the final end users in order to provide an effective primary food care. So in order to fulfill this gap, Nectar project provides some important results. What are these results? First of all, we shaped an occupational profile, so a set of competencies that characterized a new innovative figure named Chef Gastroengineering. Once defined this occupational profile in the first 8 months of the project, we, based on the main standards that we will see during this webinar, European standards for vocational education and training, we drafted the first release, so it's not a definitive version, but a first release of an European curriculum for chef gastroengineering. Aside to this curriculum, we put a pool of tools, practical, very practical tools that helps designers and teachers to use the curriculum that is supposed to be very general and adaptable to every European country, to use this curriculum and to adapt it to their local rules and situation and institutions and so on. So at the end of the first year of the project, all of these tools, so all of these results, the occupational profile, the curriculum and the designer kit has been used in order to design some pilot courses. These courses will, as you know, are going to start now in 4 main countries, 2 in Italy, in Liguria and Campania, 1 in Austria, 1 in Portugal and 1 in Belgium. The main aim of pilots is to test the efficacy of the tools, of the results produced in the first part of the project, mainly the curriculum and the designer's kit, in order to allow project partners to release a final version of them at the end of the project, at the end of the third year of the project, refined accordingly to an evaluation carried out throughout the project based on the experience of the pilot courses. In order to support the implementation of these pilots, the project also produced other tools. For instance, there has been the customization of the IMOOCs platform. So the IMOOCs platform is a platform already used in the Medical University of Graz that has been customized for the purpose of the Nectar project in order to allow both the implementation of the NOT and the implementation of the online component of the pilots. Then we produced online materials and we produced also materials supporting the teachers, the lesson plans and the training patterns that will be the objectives, the contents of module 3 and module 4 of our NOT course. Is there any question till now?
Oh, no, silence. It's clear.
Thank you. Thank you for your voice feedback. Okay, so I try to introduce very shortly the results I just named. Anyway, if you would like to go deeper in some of them, if you would like to clarify something, you can ask to our email address and we can send you additional information and documents. Okay, anyway, the PDF I suggested you for download at the beginning of this webinar includes more information than the ones I'm able to provide you in this webinar. Okay, so let's start with the occupational profile. So in order to shape the occupational profile, we have identified as a first step 7 main key activities characterizing the chef gastroengineer. How they are defined, the key activities? A key activity is an integrated group of professional competencies which are in their entirety necessary to perform a task relevant to the job profile. So the key activities of one profession must together cover all the activities for the performance of a profession, regardless of its application in a specific context. Once identified these main 7 key activities, we also identified from 3 to 5 core competencies that are needed to perform each activity. This is, I'm not going to read all of these lines, okay, but just to show you how the occupational profile is shaped. So here in the left side, you have the key activity, and on the right side, you have the list of the related core competencies from 3 to 5 for each key activity we have identified. So here are the first 3, and here are the last 4. Then, as I said, the occupational profile has been delivered at month 6 of the project. Then, starting from the occupational profile, we developed the curriculum. The curriculum is supposed to be very general because, as you can imagine, we have to shape something that should be used, could be used, may be used by every designer in any European country. So it should be as much as possible across the board and modular and flexible in order to be adaptable to different contexts and different rules that we can find in the different European countries. Okay. The first release delivered at the end of the first year of the curriculum includes 79 learning outcomes. Then we'll see what they are. These 79 learning outcomes are grouped into 7 units that correspond to the 7 key activities defined in the occupational profile. So at the end, each learning outcome is characterized by an alphanumerical code that mirrors the core competence and the related key activities it is related to, and in this way it maintains a sort of mapping to the occupational profile. In this slide, we have an example of a learning outcome and of the template we used in order to formalize them. So this is a description of one learning outcome. The curriculum is composed by 79 of these tables, let me say, okay? So as you can see, the learning outcome is characterized by a code and a title. And then it is structured through 3 main fields, identifying the corresponding knowledge, skill, and personal and transversal competencies. And these are formalized in terms of what a student is supposed to, which achievement a student is supposed to achieve at the end of the course. So in terms of knowledge, for instance, we have described the main swallowing problem. In terms of skill, analyze and evaluate how clients can take in modified meals, and et cetera, et cetera. So the focus is on the student, and the competencies addressed are defined in terms of knowledge, skills, and personal and transversal competencies. Then we defined if the learning outcome is mandatory or optional, possible links to other learning outcomes. So if there is a link with other learning outcomes or if the learning outcome is preparatory for other ones, the AQF level, then we will see what is the AQF level. It is one of the standards we have to comply with. And other notes concerning the learning outcome. Any question till now? Oh, okay. So I put here this email, this slide with this question, because I think that maybe is the question that appeared, came up in your minds as soon as you have watched the previous slide. Okay, why learning outcomes? Because we have to comply with the main European tools for vocational education and training. Because these tools will allow us will allow for transparency of the certification, will allow for their transferability, for the mobility of students, and so on. One of the main standards for vocational education and training for VET is the AC VET, so the European Credit System for Vocational Education and Training. And this standard states that each curriculum developed, which would like to be transferable and supporting transparency and so on, should be based on learning outcomes. They defined learning outcomes as statements of what a learner knows, understands, and is able to do on completion of a learning process, which are defined in terms of knowledge, skills, and competence. This is a definition given by one of the main agencies, European agencies dealing with VET standards. So learning outcomes, LOAS is the acronym, are described from the perspective of the learner, not from the perspective of the teacher. Okay, so this is an exercise to phrase learning outcomes, because you have to focus on this perspective, so the perspective of the learner, but you are also supposed to use active verbs, so in the infinitive form, and to identify measurable and observable actions. In such a way, you will be able to shape in the proper way the learning outcomes, support properly the assessment of the learning outcomes, and so on. Our curriculum is also mapped against what is called the European Qualification Framework, EQF. Many of you already knows what is EQF, but just to have a common base for everyone. Okay, the EQF is an European framework that defines 8 main reference levels for qualification and allows an Italian school to be compared to a Greek school or to a Belgian one. And it also defines some descriptors indicating how learning outcomes should be if they are settled at a specific EQF level. Just to provide you some examples, so the secondary education correspond to EQF 4, short higher education programs correspond to EQF 5, bachelor's degree, so the first level at academic level, EQF 6, master's degree, EQF 7, and the PhD doctorate, EQF 8. And here are some examples of how they set the learning outcomes for each level. So here we have the two main levels interested by the project, so level 4 and level 5. And here is how the EQF describes the knowledge, the skills, and the responsibility and autonomy that should be achieved by students awarded by a certification at level 4 and level 5. And our curriculum is just mapped against these levels in order to assure the compliance with this standard. In particular, we defined that the curriculum targets cooks and chefs with at least EQF 4 level. It depends on the country, okay? Because in some countries, they don't use the same name for the same profession. So at the end, we decided to refer to an European classification whose name is ISCO classification, that is a classification of occupations that is available online if you would like to check it. Okay, so we referred to the definition of the chef set at the QF4 level in the ESCO classification that corresponds to a secondary school diploma, and decide to target people, so people who are endowed with such a diploma, with such a level, can enter our curriculum. Okay, so once achieved the learning outcomes addressed by the curriculum and completed the course, okay, the student could be awarded with a certification corresponding to the chef gastroengineer qualification that is set at AQF5 level. So our curriculum takes a possible student from AQF4 to AQF5. But since not all countries in Europe have the possibility to set up an AQF5 level course for this certification, our curriculum has been shaped in order to allow for its adaptation to AQF4. So in some countries, if it can be adapted to a course awarding an AQF5, but it can be also adapted to courses that award AQF4. And our project wanted to stress this flexibility and testing the efficacy of the curriculum with respect to this adaptation and this flexibility. And thus, we will have through two of our five pilots setting up a course addressing a specialization within a QR4 level, and three pilots reaching a qualification of AQF5. Is this clear? Do you have any question about this? Apparently not. Okay, thank you. Last point about standard, I think the most difficult one, is the one about the CVET points. So as you know, in at the academic level, we can manage credits using ACTS. So ACTS is the English name for the credits, the academic credits that are used across Europe, and the students can get recognized their titles from one country to another, from one institution to another, using such a credits. In the undergraduate world, it is more difficult to have such a recognition, such a transferability of credits. And to this end, the European Union has set up the tool of ACVET points. ACVET points aims to compensate, to fill the gap of the management of credits in the world of undergraduate qualification. Okay, so what are ACVET points? They are a numerical representation of the overall weight of learning outcomes and of the relative weight of the units in relation to the qualification. So at the end, they correspond to ACTS in QF3, 4, 5 levels. And especially when we deal with the QF4 and the QF5, we can try to compare one ACVET point with one ACTS. So in our project, I don't know, we have documents and pages talking about this, but I don't want to bore you with this. Just letting you know that at the end, we have identified as a right compromise that 1 year of formal vocational education and training correspond to 60 ACVET points that like 1 year of academic courses correspond to 60 ACTS and correspond to about 1,500 hours of student workload. Okay? Fixing these numbers in our project and in our minds, we tried to work assigning the ACVET points to each learning outcome as prescribed by the ACVET standards. Instead of assigning a fixed number of points to each learning outcome, so when you achieve that learning outcome, you automatically are awarded with this number of learning outcomes, this number of points of credits, we identified a range of ACVET points from 1 to 3. At least at the level of the curriculum, leaving the definition of the definitive number of points to the designer of the specific course. So, for instance, when our pilot leaders designed the specific pilot in Austria, they took the curriculum and the curriculum with that assigns a range of points to each learning outcome and defined the exact number of points to be assigned to each learning outcome and the overall number of points at the end that will be awarded to the course. Based on the overall number of the credits assigned to the course could be an AQI-4 or an AQI-5. So let's come back to our results. So as I said, we have the occupational profile, the curriculum, and then the designer kit. What is the designer kit? As you can imagine, since we had to be compliant with all of these standards, and so we had to develop a curriculum that is very general, because at the end, if you remember the slide with the learning outcome, the table with the learning outcome, the curriculum is exactly 70, made of 79 boxes like this. So this is an upper level definition of the curriculum, but if you have to design something to be implemented in your school, okay, maybe you need some support in order to take this list of learning outcomes and to shape actually your local course, okay? And to this end, the project developed the designer's kit, that is a set of 11 guides and tools aimed to support any designer in Europe to localize the general curriculum in his or her own context. The design process we imagined is an intermediate step that allows to create a localized curriculum and then specific courses. What is a localized curriculum? So we started from the general curriculum, and then the localized curriculum is an intermediate definition of an intermediate step in the design process when you define the modules of your course. Because if you think about the structure of the curriculum is structured by units, but units are not corresponding to modules. Okay, so if you want, you can create 7 modules in your course. But if you don't want, you can create 10 modules and take learning outcomes transversally to the units of learning outcomes that are planned in the curriculum. So localized curriculum define the modules. You select the learning outcomes because, as we said, there are some learning outcomes that are mandatory and others optional. So you can decide if you want to include the optional ones and which ones or not. And then you can assign the proper number, as we said, the proper number of ACPR points to each learning outcome in order to obtain the overall number of learning credits for your course, and thus the overall weight of your course in terms of workload, and thus the AQF level of your course. Then the localized curricula should be fairly detailed in the detailed design of the specific course. So this course will be run from October 2023 to June 2024, I don't know, in this university with these teachers, in this classroom and so on. So with very detailed design of pilots. I have not time to introduce you to the whole set of the 11 tools, okay? But just to provide you some examples, I included some pictures in this presentation. Anyway, if you want to take a look at them, they are available and we are helpful to send them to you. This is an example of the tool. This is the ACPR point table. So this table is the one providing the range that I told you before of credits. So for each learning outcome, each line corresponds to a learning outcome, code, name, the fact if it is mandatory or not. And then you have a minimum and the maximum of ACPR points that you can assign to that learning outcome, taking in consideration the overall number of credits that you could identify for a course at AQF 5, so from 60 to 90, for a course that is in the middle of AQF 4, AQF 5, so from 40 to 60, and the course that is surely AQF 4, from 30 to 40. Based on this information, each pilot leader defined the proper number of ACPR points for each learning outcome and the overall number of credits assigned to the course. This picture is important to allow you to understand how we used our tools, because it shows the multi-layered approach to the design of pilots that we adopted in the project. So I hope that I was able to share with you what is the idea of a progressive design that we implemented in the project, starting from a curriculum, a general curriculum, layer zero, that is supposed to be very general. So at the end, we have those tables with titles and knowledge, skills and competencies defined at very general level, okay? But it is not enough in order to implement a practical course, an actual course in a specific institution, in a specific timing and so on. So the first step is to localize this general curriculum, what we call layer one, localize the general curriculum in a localized curriculum, identifying the modules, the learning outcomes you've selected in terms of optional or mandatory, and the credits assigned to the number of credits assigned to them. Then Serena, we have other, sorry?
Serena, can I ask something?
Yeah.
Small question. The localized curricula, that, if I understand it, is going to happen after the Nectar project.
No. Is what we formalized is the next slide, but maybe I can just switch to it. Is what has been formalized in the tool we called the flexibility tool, exactly what analyzed in the meeting before.
Okay.
So the Excel file, the flexibility tool, is the one supposed to formalize, to allow the designers to formalize choices about modules, about the selected learning outcomes, and about the number of credits.
Yeah, I am asking this because, as you know, the general curriculum, the current general curriculum, is, to our opinion, much too detailed. Should be more general.
Yeah.
So I'm not sure if this is possible to do this within Nectar project, or should this happen after the project?
Yeah, it is as if you remember the second slide I showed you, the aim of pilots is to test the first draft of the curriculum in order to shape a final version of the curriculum for the end of the project. Yeah. So the implementation of pilots is the way we collect the feedback from in the design phase, and in the implementation phase is the way we collect feedback from partners in order to understand how to improve the general curriculum. So it's a cycle, it's an evaluation cycle, allowing us to come back to the general curriculum and also to the designer's kit that is based on the curriculum in order to deliver a final version.
Well, so I am asking this because we do not have that much time after the pilots, if I'm not
wrong.
Yeah,
but the main feedbacks, I think that could be collected in the design phase. So, and that is just finished, okay? Yeah. So I think that, okay, the collection of the evaluation from pilots, from the opinions of teachers, the opinions of students is fundamental in order to understand the effectiveness of pilots. Yeah. But a lot of feedback could be collected by now, okay? From designers which used the general curriculum, used our tools, and exactly like you are saying, maybe it's too detailed. Why you are saying this? Because you experienced the design and you noted that there is something that could be improved. So from now on, we have 1 year enough in order to be able to improve to improve the general curriculum, independently from the running of the pilots, which could give us additional feedback. But we can start from now to review the first release.
Okay.
Is it clear?
Yes, that's very good news, in fact.
So I don't know, maybe the people involved in this webinar are not so inside the project, but we have a specific work package, so a specific activity coordinated by the University of Algarve that is aimed to support us in the collection of such feedbacks and to support the improvement of the curriculum. So this is the last slide I would like to introduce you, but this is important because it allows us to understand what's the aim of three main tools that we are going to use in the next weeks, both for your activity, so the activity in the NOT course, and for your activity as teachers in pilot courses. So it's important for you to understand what is the role of the flexibility tool, that is an Excel file that you will see in the form of PDF, because we have printed each sheet in a PDF for usability, let me say. That allows the formalization of the choices of the localized curricula. And then we have another tool named Course Syllabus, that is a Word document, so a textual one, that is divided in two parts, Part A and Part B. Part A allows us to formalize a general description of the modules identified in the localized curricula. And then the layer three allows us to go deeper and deeper in the design of pilots, describing the specific teachings. So your teaching as teachers, okay? And the assessment of students and the schedule of the course. So more and more detailed. So please, if you have a paper in front of you and you want to take note of something drawn from the webinar of today, take note. Flexibility tool, okay? The flexibility tool is an Excel file that allows to formalize localized curricula. So an IGEL level information of the localization of the curriculum, and then course syllabus part A and part B.